One of the commanders, he liked me a lot. He tried to give me an M16 rifle and he said, look, you should fight for me because I like you. And I picked up my camera and I said, no, I work with this, not the guns, you know? My name is Dai Kurokawa. I'm a Japanese photojournalist. I've worked in Nairobi, Kenya, and in Africa for the past decade. This is a photograph of Congolese government soldiers during a conflict between the government and the rebel group called M23. This shot was taken just before the fighting broke out. They were quite happy, and as you can see, this man was drinking. And then I was basically told to go away, and I could not stay there anymore because they threatened me with the gunpoint. DR Congo is the biggest country in sub-Saharan Africa, and it's blessed with very rich natural resources. But unfortunately, the natural resource doesn't look like they're doing any good for the people. They've been fighting over the minerals, who controls the minerals. A lot of times, that is the curse. Next one is this. As I tried to go closer to the next town called Sake, where the government soldier has been retreated to, me and this Japanese journalist named Tadashi Sugiyama, we had to go through checkpoints run by a local militia called Mai Mai. Not many Western journalists come across the Mai Mai soldiers. They're not very accessible, and a lot of people think they're very crazy. They're very unpredictable, and then, which is, I think, is true. This rebel fighter in this photograph, he is smoking a cigarette that I gave him, and he was standing in front of us with a big gun, telling us that he likes Tadashi. Tadashi is very white and thin, and you know that he's my type. Is this guy trying to rape Tadashi? No, this is a problem, so we have to do something. And we're all gonna turn back and tell him that we're gonna bring back more cigarettes. And we're gonna pretend like we're gonna grab packs of cigarettes and bring it to him, but actually we're gonna jump in a car and just, you know, drive away. And that's exactly what we did. In Congo, rape is still being used as the weapon of war. It's very common in Congo, women and men. Working in Africa does not come without the risks. I know many colleagues who've been hurt while working, and I have myself come across quite sticky situations. I was covering this very small, minor, peaceful protest. I mean, I've covered these protests, hundreds of them in the past. Everything was going well until at one point, I remember I turned around to look at the police officers. He was raising a tear gas launcher. He was about less than 10 meters away from me. He was aiming right at me. When I heard that bang, I fell in pain. And then, you know, some of the protesters, they came to rescue me. They picked me up and evacuated me, and I went to the hospital. It was something that I realized that you don't have to be in a war zone. It could happen a small, minor protest like this. This picture shows a government official standing in front of illegal firearms, looking at them. In Kenya, the government organized this event in order to control the flow of the illegal firearms in the country. They made several piles of these rifles and they burnt them all on the ground. There were many spectators. The local people came to watch the event. These guns were obviously all supposed to be not loaded. I don't think many of us trusted a Kenyan authority, and I don't think many locals did either. So when the guns started burning, we started hearing all these pops. Pop, pop, pop. When we started hearing these pops, the local people, they started running. They started fleeing the scene, you know. You know, at one point, the vice president, you know, he was there, and he started running away, so. The first time I went to Somalia, the country was suffering from the famine that hit the whole region, East Africa region. More than a quarter of a million people are said to have died, and more than half of them were children under five. It was devastating famine. Hospitals were overwhelmed, and mothers were desperate because they couldn't do anything about their children getting sick. There were private militia groups, Mali National Army, and God knows who. This particular photo of the African Union soldier was taken in an area called Afgoye, which was the front line of the battle with Al-Shabaab at that time. the front windshield of a military truck. It was visually striking, so I just took the shot, and it was just something to show the intensity of the fighting then. This picture was taken in the Dadaab refugee camp. It's on the border with between Somalia and Kenya, in northern Kenya. And this is a madras, like Islamic school run by the refugees. This round shape was sort of interesting, so I climbed up on a tree and shot it from the top of the tree. And the children were using these Quran boards to practice their writing and the recital of the Quran verses. I was very impressed with this madrasa, their desire to educate and to be educated in a time like this. All they had with this Quran board, you know, and they were still trying to learn, trying to be educated, and it was very moving, yes. This photograph shows a woman sleeping in a chapel being used as a makeshift IDP camp in eastern Congo. In the background here, it says in Swahili, the Jesus is there. These IDP, these people, women, they were raped by rebel fighters, and the other would tell me that they were robbed by government soldiers. You know, so they were being attacked by both sides, the rebels and the government soldiers. It's like any other war, you know, the people who suffer is always the civilians. I mean, everybody loses in war in Congo. People, particularly in developed countries, often we forget that our fortune is almost always built on somebody else's misfortune. I would hope my pictures evoke this sense of justice or the conscience among people, you know, and bring out the goodness that we all have in our hearts.